Good morning, everybody. Good morning to everybody on Facebook and everybody who will be watching us later online. Can everybody hear me? Well, why not? Just a minute.
We just had that mic check and didn't even turn it on.
Okay. So, are we good now? Okay. I want to say hi because Don's brother Rod is over here, and I didn't know that, and his wife Jerry. So that's just lovely. Happy Father's Day to everybody out there, the grandfathers, the stepfathers, the father figures. May you enjoy your special day. I don't have many announcements. Doug and Wyatt and Blair are on their way to Down East Maine, along with folks from All Souls Church, to work on mission projects this week. So we send them off with our prayers and our thanks. Pastor Carl is away this week. He'll be back next Sunday. So in the meantime, we office people have an in-house vacation, which is always welcome. So we are having Bible study through the summer. And starting on July 27th, Rick Spearing will be leading a study on the book Pilgrim's Progress. There are details in the bulletin, and I hope you give this some thought, because it'll be fun. Anything that Rick leads is fun. So until then, we are taking a closer look at the parables each Wednesday night. So please consider joining us. And please take a moment to read your bulletin, pray for all those on our prayer list, and just read it to be made aware of what's going on in this wonderful church family. So as the Christ candles are lighted, please take a moment to relax and prepare ourselves for this morning's worship. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Holy and loving God, today on this earthly Father's Day, we gather to worship you, our Heavenly Father, for we are your sons and daughters made in your image. Although often we do not act like we are your sons and daughters, and for those times we ask your forgiveness and we repent. Have mercy on us, Lord. Sometimes we forget to be thankful for all you have given us in this life. But we are thankful, Lord. And right now, we're going to take a moment to thank you in private for all of our blessings. We thank you, Lord, for this church family. always ready to step up and help each other and the greater community. We thank you for our pastor and pray that he and his family have a fun and safe week together. We ask for blessings on Doug and Blair and Wyatt and all those heading out for mission work this week. We ask for prayers for all those listed in our church bulletin, for military men and women all over the world, and for their families as well. For all government officials, from our president right down to our local officials. We pray for the board members and the volunteers of this church and every person who enters through our doors. May they feel the love of Christ and the Holy Spirit at work here. We pray, Lord, for mercy on those who are searching for something greater in their lives and have not yet turned to you. Mercy for those who have lost faith. For those who are against us, we pray for them. We pray and reach out to those who have never heard the word of salvation. For those whose hearts have been hardened for whatever reason. We pray for the hungry and the homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, for those in loneliness, fear, and sorrow, and for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair. We pray for people everywhere according to their needs. We humbly pray for this nation, Lord, and all nations facing division in so many different ways. We pray for Ukraine and all other nations facing wars and destruction. We come to you, Lord, with all these thoughts and hopes as we turn to you and pray the prayer you taught us to say, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, we'll sing our first hymn, number 392, Take Time to Be Holy. And the hymnals you'll find underneath your seats. Please be seated. It's been said that we can't outgive God, and I think we know that. There's so many different ways to give our tithes and offerings, our time, our prayers, and ourselves in music. So this morning, Patrick is going to come up and he's going to provide the music during our offertory. If the ushers and deacons will please come forward.
You know, after doing this so many times, you'd think it'd get easier coming up here, but nope, I'm still petrified and nervous. So how's everyone doing? All right, so I decided to choose this song. This song, by the way, is called Without You by the Christian group Ashes Remain. I've known of this song for a while, and it's one of my absolute favorite songs to be able to sing, not only because of what the song is about, because the main story of the song is how without a good relationship with God in our lives, then at what's really the point? Because without him, who are we? But I've also taken this as a more personal meaning the past few years, because as you'll hear and see with the lyrics of the song, this can mean a multitude of things. And with it also being Father's Day, I want to take the opportunity to also embarrass my dad, because with this song, he knows everything that's been going on with me lately, and without him being able to welcome me back up to Maine multiple times after everything that's happened with me and support me no matter what, I don't know where I would be without him in my life. And so this is my chance to also embarrass you, Dad, because you've embarrassed me way too many times for me to count in my life. So go ahead and play it, Aaron.
So desperate just to see your face. Meet me in this broken place. Hold me now. I need to feel you. Show me how to make it new again. There's no one I can run to. And nothing I could ever do. I'm nowhere if I'm here without you. Even if you take it all away, I'll wait. Even when the light begins to fade, I'll wait for you. I'm so desperate calling out your name. Meet me in this broken place. Hold me now, I need to feel you. Show me how to make it new again. There's no one I can run to, and nothing I could ever do. I'm nowhere if I'm here. I'm tired of running and wrestling with these angels. I lay down my life and I surrender. Hold me now, I need to feel you. Show me how to make it new again. There's no one I can run to, and nothing I could ever do. Hold me now, I need to feel you. Show me how to make it new again. There's no one I can run to, and nothing I could ever do. I'm nowhere if I'm here without you.
And the only other reason for me coming up here is also to, if you haven't seen it in your bulletins, the reason tonight is also hosting a karaoke event since Doug's not going to be here. That's run by Harlan and I, so if anyone here wants to come out and participate in karaoke with the reason, you're free to join.
Heavenly Father, we ask for blessings, blessings on these offerings that we give to you today. We return to you today, actually, Father, because they all come from you. So please take them and multiply them and guide us as to how these can best serve you to further your kingdom here on earth. In your Son's name we pray all this. Amen. Oh, and I guess I'll ask you to stand again. We'll go to hymn number 410. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Please be seated. Before I get started with the scripture and the message, I want to wish Tamara a safe and blessed trip as she returns to Finland to see her family and friends. And you will be missed, but I hope you have a great time. So, at this time, would you please join me in the unison prayer? Lord, upon the pages of this book is your story. It is also our story. Open our eyes that we may see, our ears that we may hear, our minds that we may understand, and our hearts that they may be changed. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first scripture reading comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verses 1 through 5. The Lord says, I was ready to respond, but no one asked for help. I was ready to be found, but no one was looking for me. I said, here I am, here I am, to a nation that did not call on my name. All day long, I opened my arms to a rebellious people, but they follow their own evil paths and their own crooked schemes. All day long, they insult me to my face by worshiping idols in their sacred gardens. They burn incense on pagan altars. At night, they go out among the graves, worshiping the dead. They eat the flesh of pigs and make stews with other forbidden foods. Yet they say to each other, don't come too close or you will defile me. I am holier than you. These people are a stench in my nostrils, an acrid smell that never goes away. Our next reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 8, verses 26 through 39. They sailed to the region of Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or had lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus, Son of Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me. For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus asked him, what is your name? Legion, he replied, because many demons had gone into him. And they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in town and countryside, and the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away saying, return home and tell how much God has done for you. So the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. May God bless our understanding of these powerful and holy words. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So I called this message Angels and Demons. So just what are demons? Well, I wasn't sure. So I looked it up, and they are actually fallen angels. When Satan was thrown out of heaven because he wanted to be equal to God, about one-third of the angels went with him instead of staying and worshiping God. That alone shows you just how convincing Satan can be. I personally had never given much thought to demons. I think we used the word casually. It made me think of a book by C.S. Lewis called The Screwtape Letters. I reread the book while preparing for this message. It's about a fallen angel writing letters to his nephew, another fallen angel, and giving him pointers on how to turn this man that he was assigned to away from God. It's fiction, of course, but like all his works, it rings true in so many ways. So it makes sense that if we believe in angels, the ones in heaven, then we must believe in fallen angels or demons, good and evil, God and Satan. Although we must never say that Satan has the same amount of evil power as God has heavenly power. Satan is not omniscient or omnipresent. He has nowhere near the power of God. Pastor Kyle says it all the time, you know, that Satan has no more power than what we give him. That actually Satan would be a counterpart of an archangel such as Michael or Gabriel. Demons, fallen angels, evil spirits, however we describe them, their job is to make us miserable people. They use tools like jealousy, selfishness, loose morals, addictions, vanity, all those things that go against everything Christians are supposed to be. They put people and opportunities in our paths that lure us and tempt us away from God. And they do it so smoothly that sometimes, or often really, we don't even realize what is happening. So getting back to the scripture, this poor man, Legion, ran to Jesus, who then commanded the demons or evil spirits to come out of the man. So the spirits begged Jesus not to send them into the abyss or the lake of fire. See, they knew who Jesus was and what he could do to them. And there was a large herd of pigs nearby, and the demons begged to be put into the pigs. And Jesus complied. The pigs then ran down a steep bank and into the lake, and they all drowned. I don't think spirits can drown, but... So why did Jesus do what they asked? As we hear often in the New Testament, the time had not yet come. Jesus knew that God has an appointed time for all things, and the spirits would end up in the lake of fire with Satan when God says so. It just wasn't their time. Now, while Jesus was walking this earth, he drove demons out of people if they asked him to. And it's the same today. These demons, these bad thoughts, bad habits, things that keep us from giving ourselves wholly to God, can be taken away. How? By asking for help. And no, they won't be zapped out of us and into a herd of pigs, but we must put in effort by praying and consciously working on stopping these things from taking over our lives. Like everything else in a Christian life, it comes down to trusting in our Lord and Savior and studying His Word. The answer to all our dilemmas are in here. Do you believe that? Do you want more peace in your life? Study this. Do you want to stop feeling like you're not worthy of love or feeling like you're not good enough? Study this. Come to Bible study. Talk to other Christians. You know, that there's a part of the scripture in Luke that confused me and made me wonder. That was verse 37 when they said, "Then all the people of the region of Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear." Well, why were they overcome with fear? One reason that kind of came into my head was, what are they going to tell their boss? Oh, we lost our herd of pigs because the Son of Man zapped a bunch of demons into them and they went over the edge. That would make him fearful, I would think. But why weren't they happy for Legion and happy to learn that demons could be defeated? Makes no sense to me. But here's another thought. Perhaps they and we are okay with our demons. Maybe they and we like our lives the way they are. You got to admit, there were and maybe still are times in our lives when it is or it was kind of fun to be naughty. Don't worry, no one will find out. One more drink, what'll it harm? What happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. Or just even things that you think. Wow, did she get dressed in the dark? What is she wearing? No one will care if I do this. I'm not hurting anyone. I think we can get very comfortable with our demons. They become a part of us, and it is very difficult to make changes, even with divine help. And then when the demons do leave, where does that leave us? We change. We may no longer hang out with the same people because we won't have as much in common anymore. Our family and friends may not recognize this new person, and if they do, they may not like us. Perhaps they feel uncomfortable around us now. It's happened to me, and I'll share this with you because you know that's what I do. It's still happening to me, and I have to say, it's very hurtful. And this last time, this particular person said some ridiculous things about me. I was devastated by their hateful feelings for me. People say to me, well, that's their problem, not yours. Well, that's true to some point, but it's still a horrible thing to have someone you have known and loved your whole life, a member of your family, have those feelings. And that's just what Satan wants, discourse among families, anything that will keep us away from God. This person was my demon for a while, because I realized after a couple of weeks that I hadn't even picked up my Bible for my daily studies. That's how distracted I was. It's so easy to get caught up in things that bring you down. According to C.S. Lewis, Satan believes that there is nothing like suspense and anxiety to keep a human's mind away from God, and that the safest road to hell is the gradual one, the gentle slope, the soft underfoot, without sudden turnings, without milestones, without signposts. That is certainly something to ponder. So we have to ask ourselves, just what is the purpose of demons? For Christians, the answer to that, I think, is just the opposite of what Satan intends. Satan sends the demons to tempt us and lure us away from our Savior. But instead, those demons can drive us closer to God if we're paying attention, if we are following Christ. It should be impossible for Satan to turn a Christian over to his side. In fact, it is impossible if we keep ourselves full of God's word. We should be so full of the Holy Spirit that it overflows, and therefore there is no room for demons. Sounds strange, doesn't it? That there are actually these spirits among us fighting for our souls. But it's true, and it says so in here. If we say we believe in God and his word, then we have to believe all of it, not just what we think we understand or the parts we like. There are some very hard truths in here. Remember the first couple of verses in Isaiah. I was ready to respond, but no one asked for help. I was ready to be found, but no one was looking for me. I said, here I am to a nation that did not call on my name. Now that was God speaking. Oh my gosh, that has to be one of the saddest verses in the whole Bible to me. He is the answer, but we're not asking the right questions. If we were, and we listened real hard for the answers, many of us would not find ourselves in the messes we're in. This nation certainly wouldn't be in the state that it is in, and the world wouldn't be in the chaos it's in. I would like to make one final point. Pastor Carl warned me not to go off in too many directions, to find one basic point and to stick to it, but I think that ship has sailed. I can't do that, Pastor Carl. I said earlier that demons knew who Jesus was and what he could do to them. They knew him from the beginning. So they believed he was real. We believe Jesus is real. We believe in the Trinity. So let me ask you, what is the difference between the demons and us? I hate to say it, but sometimes I'm afraid there's not much difference. But my real point is it enough to just say, I believe in Jesus Christ? No, it's not. That alone does not make us a Christian, any more than simply being a good person will get you into heaven. I heard Joyce Meyer say once, sitting in a church doesn't make you a Christian any more than sitting in a garage makes you a car. We know it takes faith. Faith that leads to good works, plus God's grace and mercy. We can't do anything worthwhile on our own. Most of us have learned that the hard way. God's mercy and grace, that is the good news we must keep in our minds. 1/3 of the angels in heaven followed Satan. That means 2/3 of the angels stayed with God and are working on our behalf. That's 2 against 1. But more importantly, there is one God, and he has no equal. He is our victory over death. Amen?
Amen.
So let's stand and sing our last hymn, which I thought was very appropriate after this message. There's a sweet, sweet spirit. Please rise. So as we leave this place today, leave your demons behind and take the sweet, sweet spirit with you. Happy Father's Day, and have a wonderful week.